Welcome. I'm Kenji Liu, and I've been running the Oakland Word program since November of last year. And congratulations, everybody, on the book and everybody who's in the book. Let me see who's in the book here. See, there's about 53 people in this book, and how many pages is this book? 172, something like that. All right, so we're going to have some readings, we're going to have some music, we're going to have some food. If you haven't already, make sure you get some food, although hold off on any crunchy stuff while the readings are going on. And we'll get right to it. So, first of all, we have DJ Max Champ here in the house. And let me see, where's Linda? I just want to say hi to Linda Gonzalez, who is one of our instructors. As well as Oscar Benmeo, who has been the instructor for the June-July classes. I should definitely be doing a bunch of thank yous, but actually they're all on sort of the first page. So let me just do some quick ones. You might know that the funding for this came from the California State Library. It was a one-time grant, and which means that it won't be continuing, unfortunately, unless somebody has $50,000. Although it's... What is cool is that we applied for the grant again for a slightly different program because you can't apply for the same program twice, and we did get that grant. So it'll be for an Oakland Word type program, but for Oakland high schools.
Cool.
So, I don't know, Oakland Words. Oakland Words younger.
The next
generation. Yes. And I'm excited, you know, for that to go forward because I think that, you know, I was looking at the website for Youth Speaks in San Francisco and I was really enjoying their mission because it talks about how Youth Speaks as an organization tries to sort of fight misperceptions of youth by helping them give a platform for them to express themselves and, you know, tell everybody in their own words what they're about, and I think in Oakland that's a really important thing. Because I think there's a lot of misinformation about Oakland youth. All right, so I also, before moving on to the readers, I also want to recognize Nicole de Ayora, who was one of the people involved with writing the original grant for this program. So she, that was, it was kind of her brain child. So let me just read my introduction as a way of getting into it. And you can all follow along with me. It's right after the acknowledgments. So, I once took a Black Panther Party tour of Oakland. On a gray day, David Hilliard, founding member and chief of staff of the Panthers, pulled up to DeFremery Park, also known as Bobby Hutton Park, in a full-size van. For the next few hours, we visited every major landmark in the party's struggle for Black self-determination. Flashes. A traffic light they fought tooth and nail to get installed near a school at a dangerous intersection, 55th and Market. The party's first office on Martin Luther King Jr. Way, formerly Grove Street, where we bought pastries from its current bakery tenants. That's It's All Good Bakery. The house where little Bobby Hutton was fatally shot by Oakland police. It was on this tour that I began to understand Oakland. Before, it was only a place I lived in. Afterward, I saw history layered over every block. Not just Black history, but also American Indian, Asian American, Chicano, European, working class, women's, queer, and many others. I started to feel connected to the city because I could sense these histories around me. Oakland is full of stories. How could it not be when its people come from every continent, pushing and jostling, mixing and fighting, working and building together? I'm interested in them all. Oakland also has a long history of writers. Some may know that Jack London and Gertrude Stein lived here, but many other writers are part of this city, representing a literary legacy and present reality that is deeply multicultural and polyvocal. Enter Oakland Word. The idea was simple, a series of 20 free creative writing workshops and seminars at Oakland Public Library sites in some of the most under-resourced Oakland communities. Local writers and poets, some bilingual, taught short fiction, poetry, memoir, blogging, and songwriting. New and emerging writers signed up en masse, filling almost all classes to capacity with waitlists for most. The majority were Oaklanders, women, people of color, and in their 20s, 30s, and 40s. Most agreed that the $0 price tag was a significant factor in their ability to participate. Well-known adult educator Paulo Freire has said that to read and write the word is to read and write the world. Language is more than communication. It's a way of negotiating and asserting meaning, a process of becoming. Through creative writing, we can tell stories about how the world was, is, or could be, and about the limitations and possibilities of our present society. Through stories, we can imagine, self-reflect, and act. This liberatory understanding of literacy was the basis for Oakland Word's curriculum, writing the word, writing the world. 75 years ago, during the New Deal, the Works Progress Administration's Federal Writers Project employed writers and poets in California, to whom a memorial was built in Oakland in 1939 to 40. And if you ever get a chance, you should check out that memorial. It's up in the hills. If the Federal Writers Project had not existed, many important voices might be absent today, among them Richard Wright, Zora Neale Hurston, and Ralph Ellison. How many all over the world have been influenced by them? In this spirit, I hope that everyone touched by Oakland Word will go on to touch others. Keep telling stories. You're on every block.